Hello to you fellow reef aquarium hobbyists. Welcome back to this episode of Craft Aquatic. I'm Metchy. The weather has gotten cold again here in the Northeast, so it is time to replace some heaters in the Rack and Rubble frag system. In this video, I will show you the condition of some of the one-year-old glass heaters that I have been using and the new titanium heaters that I'll be replacing them with. Here we go. Heaters are a topic that is ripe for debate in reef keeping, but it's not that difficult of a subject to address, especially compared to some of the other challenges inherent in this hobby. With that said, there are some key points that I'd like to make based on my personal experience with them over the years. We'll start with this heater here in the 15-gallon rubble section of the Rack and Rubble frag tank. By the way, I will link to several in-depth videos about the system in the description below if you'd like to dive deeper. This is a 100-watt internally set heater that is here simply to warm the water as it flows from the upper cube down to the shared sump. I'll be replacing this with an upgrade soon. And here we have two Aquion 300-watt heaters that have seen better days. I'm going to discuss these more in depth, but basically they have been in the system for a little over a year and it began to rust internally. It is hard to say whether any of this oxidation is getting out into the water, but one of the reasons I am addressing heaters now is because I have noticed more hair algae than normal in all three tanks, which can be an indicator of iron or metal in the water. Again, anecdotal, but when we do see issues in our system, it is always best to perform a process of elimination, and some of these heaters are clearly in need of replacing anyway. So I will be placing a 200-watt heater in the sump and two 300-watt heaters in these two large branches of the Rack and Rubble frag tank. All three will be controlled by two Inkbird external thermostats with Auto Aqua Smart Temp, security placed between as a backup measure. When I run the glass heaters, I use the built-in thermometers set to a slightly higher temperature as my failsafe. But as we all know, these thermostats fail quickly in the on or off position, which is why it is time to upgrade. Here we have two titanium Finnex heaters that I had installed in a previous system for several months, just soaking away there in a light acid bath. One will replace the two 300-watt Aquions in the cube and the third Aquion in the lowboy. I really like the quality of these Finnex titanium heaters. I have two of them up in the 120-gallon mixed reef. They are robust, reliable, and heat large volumes of water very quickly. They did come with these plastic guards, I guess to protect the little critters from crawling on the heaters. I feel they reduce the heater's performance, so I won't be using them. And here is my new Bulk Reef Supply 200-watt heater that I will be using in the central sump, which is basically a 10-gallon aquarium. I'll show you in a bit. This heater is of a more industrial-looking quality, built very robustly with little attention paid to finishing touches, and more to hefty, chunky reliability. One of the things I appreciate about this piece of kit is the welded titanium end cap that allows for just that little extra bit of heat transfer. Also, the rubber that is used for these suction cups is of a noticeably higher quality than most, which I will point out a bit later in the video. The top cap and seal look basic, but with good tolerances, instilling confidence that this is going to be a good addition to a longer-term heating solution. Back to the Finnex heaters for a moment, which also employ very nice high-quality top seals. The plastic and rubber feel very nice, and the titanium is finished and polished beautifully. The end caps, however, are rubber, which could be useful if there were to be oriented vertically or set in the glass substrate surface. Seeing the 300-watt Finnex and the 200-watt Bulk Reef Supply heaters next to each other, you will notice that they are similar in length. The main thing that stands out to me is the diameter of the BRS heater. Even though a lower wattage, it is larger. I can only speculate that this increased surface area will allow the heater to run a bit cooler, transferring heat from its surface to the surrounding aquarium water more efficiently. That works out well for me, as I will be using the 200-watt BRS heater in the sump, which is a smaller volume of water with a lower flow through rate. Taking a little break here to show you some trees that we have grown from avocado pits, I'll be placing these around the Rack and Rubble frag system. If they work out growing under the bluer reef lighting, I will show them in more detail in future videos. So a bit more about heaters. In glass heaters, the internal coil serves to warm up a glass tube. The glass tube then holds in a pocket of air, an envelope of heat, that also absorbs into the glass to evenly distribute and hold that heat energy. Titanium is much better at distributing heat along its surface area. Glass tends to be slightly better at maintaining heat. A titanium heater needs to shed its heat quickly in order to not burn out. For that reason, it is best in a high flow area, like an overflow or main display. I've had the best luck with glass heaters in a sump, so long as they remain submerged. This brings up another point that a titanium heater will not shatter as a glass heater can. A glass heater shattering in a sump or main display can easily crash an entire aquarium. This is why I'm changing all my heaters out to titanium, distributing them around the aquarium in a strategic manner. So the rubble or 15-gallon branch of the rack and rubble frag system will receive this 100-watt titanium heater with a built-in external thermostat. The idea is that this flow-through area is not as critical since its temperature is being maintained by the aquarium with the 300-watt heater directly above it. If the 100-watt heater fails in the on position, which is unlikely, it is a lower wattage that will be absorbed by the flow-through rate of the entire reef system. This particular brand of titanium heater with built-in thermostat employs a temperature probe that directly exits the titanium heating element. It's not ideal as it is hard to place away from the heater for an accurate temperature reading. This and the fact that the thermostats tend to fail more often than the titanium heating element is why I will not be employing these throughout the entire system. So here are those rubber suction cups again. Here's the difference between the BRS brand and the other ones. And basically, these are useless because they do not stick. They do not keep heaters securely placed. So I'd rather use maybe zip ties or something like that. At this point, the seals in most aquarium heaters are much better than they used to be. So if you can get away with it, it's much better installing them horizontally rather than vertically. When a heating element is installed this way, it tends to sit lower down in the aquarium, which allows the heat to rise through a column of solution for longer and have increased contact time with the surrounding water. Here down at sump level, you'll most likely notice a new hang in the back LG scrubber. I will be reviewing this after I've had some time running it. I don't like to do that right away. I mentioned a bit ago that I suspected some metal contamination as the culprit for increased hair algae throughout the tanks. Here is another example of how little things can creep up and add to undesirable trace levels. So now I just want to feature the difference in quality between the heating coils and the Aquion heaters in this noticeably higher quality Eheim, I guess that's how you say it, heater. This is another glass heater brand that many reef aquarists swear by. The heater has been submerged horizontally in the sump of our three-tank farm system for the same amount of time as the Aquions, and there is no condensation inside the coils, which appear to be a higher quality metal like stainless steel or titanium. They still look new. Also, the glass tube itself is larger in diameter, which I believe to be a benefit. There are less coils internally, so less to mechanically fail. Even though this heater is larger, it's only rated at 250 watts, which is likely a safer and more appropriate rating. Again, I wouldn't run this for much longer than a year, but unlike the Aquions, it will go into the backup bin rather than the recycling bin. Just a note on condensation, glass heaters are just prone to it. Generally, that is the case. This does not always mean that salt water is getting into the glass heater itself. Think of a heater like the interior of your car on a wet or cold day. The temperature and humidity difference outside can cause condensation on the windows of your vehicle if you're not venting in outside air properly. Some heaters are better at managing this and some are worse, as you can see in the comparison between these two brands. I can actually recommend the Aquion heaters too. Just make sure you replace them every year because that's what they're good for. It is now official. I have installed all titanium heaters in the rack and rubble frag system as I have in our main display upstairs. They have been running for a few weeks now with overall more stable results. Between the stability of the new heaters and a few other changes I have made, hair algae is starting to die back. I do plan on trying to run these for longer than the glass heaters. I don't actually believe that replacing heaters every year is a hard and fast rule. Like everything in reef keeping, there are exceptions and we should all make decisions based on observations having to do with our personal systems and not a generalized opinion. One last heating tip I have before ending today is that you mark the AC plug side of your heater and the portion of cable that enters your aquarium with some electrical tape or shrink wrap that matches. This will help you to problem solve quickly, which you will absolutely want to do if you are having any issues with your individual heaters. So that is it for this Craft Aquatic video. Thank you for taking the time to watch all the way through if and when you are entering the cold season. It is always a good good idea to at least check your aquarium's heating and cooling system. Hopefully some of my thoughts were helpful to you. Please do share your constructive aquarium heating ideas and opinions below, or let me know if I missed something important. It would be awesome if you hit the thumbs up and subscribed. Thank you to all of you who have subscribed already. Enjoy your reefs, and I will see you in the next one.